Good morning. How about number 140? Which is great is thy faithfulness. Number 140, great is thy faithfulness. We'll do the whole song.
Good morning. I welcome you into God's house. and pray that our time of worship can uplift our hearts and give praise to God. We have several inserts, another book practically, in our bulletin, but that just shows we're doing a lot of stuff. We have a special offering envelope this morning. This is one of our six special offering Sundays throughout the year. This is Native American Awareness Sunday. The offering that you give to Native American Ministries Sunday, over and above your regular Sunday offering, goes to promote ministries among Native American populations. First of all, in our conference, and we do have ministries to Native Americans, with Native Americans, I should say, in our conference. And also another portion of it goes to provide scholarships for leaders, Native American leaders in the church. So I encourage you to give generously to Native American Ministries Sunday offering. We will be honoring our 8th grade, senior high, VOTEC, and college grads on Sunday, May 1st during worship. So if you are one of those or have one in your family or as a friend of, encourage them to come so that we can pay our respects and honor them. Rethink Church Outreach, sponsored by our Missions Committee, is taking place again. Are we still accepting folks who want to have that? Okay. If you'd like to have some work done around your place or know someone who could, let us know at the church. Until April 15th. That'll take place on the 30th. If you would like to come and help with that, keep that in mind too. There's an insert, on the inside of that double fold, there's information about a lifeline healthcare screening we'll be holding here on the 19th of May. And then once again, word information about Vacation Bible School this summer. Are there other announcements that need to be made? Carl.
Rethink Church. We're going to send this around again to see if anybody else wants to sign up. There is the Jansen set up. The youth group's going to help. So we're going to have hopefully plenty of help, young people anyway. So we need some jobs too for people to call in. So don't forget to call in. So if you want to pass this around. Thank you.
Other announcements? Jan.
Yesterday, there were a lot of ladies in this church from all across Salina District and Hutchinson District. And we have an awesome group of ladies that stepped up to help and attend the event. And also for the men, they helped up and did a lot of extra things that was kind of beyond their normal things that they do. So I thank you for all of the help.
It was a wonderful seminar. Fine.
First of all, I want to thank everybody who stayed after church last week to see the video and to hear the presentation about the Building Information Improvement Committee. Just want to give you an update that after last week, we're at about halfway to our goal. I want you to still consider contribution to that plan. And we'll give a report on where we are next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Klein.
We should.
Alice. Oh, excuse me.
We should keep Nancy Bercher in our prayers. She's in the hospital in Salina. Nancy Bercher.
Nancy Bercher, thank you. Alice.
Okay, I know Pastor pointed out the Bible school flyer, but sometimes we don't read the fine print. We think we know everything. And if any of you adults are wanting to help with Bible school, you need to register online too. So make sure you read that little print because that needs to be as well. And if the kids are wanting a free T-shirt, that has to be done by this April 15th also. So that's really soon. Please keep that in mind. Thank you.
You want a Vacation Bible School shirt, so you need to register. Jenny, no? Oh. Anybody else? Joys or concerns? Just a second, Jim. Let me get you a microphone. Jim has some good news.
My uncle's doing better, and I'm going down there on May the 13th for my birthday and also for my niece's graduation.
That's good news, Jim. Thanks for sharing that with us. We're proud for your uncle. Other joys or concerns? Let's take a few moments now to greet one another in the name of Christ.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us join together in the call to worship. Great Spirit of God, you have healed our wounds.
You have brought us from paths of hurt and anger.
You have blessed our life that we might be a blessing to others.
Let us worship you in great joy.
Let us remember the ways that you have turned our mourning into dancing.
Let us give thanks to you forever.
Please bow for prayer. Loving God, come and speak to our hearts today. May we, like those on the Emmaus Road, find your words burning with hope in our lives. Strengthen us and give us courage for the journey ahead. For we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Let us join together and sing hymn number 454, Open My Eyes That I May See.
You may be seated. Our moment for missions this morning is for the Robbins Memorial Library. Okay, Lou.
Yeah, I'm happy to announce it is for the Robbins Memorial Library. There's nothing better than having a library in town. I think all the young kids can attest to that because we need the children to come up and take the baskets. You're right. Come and help with the baskets, those of you that... When I was a little kid, too little to read, all I could think about is I want to learn how to read. And I even carried a book home from the schoolhouse when I started first grade. We didn't have kindergarten. But I carried it home anyway. It was a Bobbsey twin book. So that when I learned to read, that was going to be the first book that I did. And I've read, and my friends can attest to that, thousands of books in my lifetime. Because if I haven't read 100 books in a year, something's gone wrong at my house. And so libraries are especially important, and children can learn so many wonderful things there. They're all high-tech now here, so they need money for high-tech things, and the computers and iPads and so forth for the kids. So we thank you for your giving to that special mission today. Thank you.
Rest of the kids to come up front and join Susan for the children's time.
Good morning. Is this on?
Yeah, okay.
So I have a balloon, and if I blow in it, what's going to happen to this balloon? It's going to get bigger. Okay, did it get bigger? Yeah. So what's inside this balloon?
Air.
Can you see the air inside this balloon?
No.
We can't see the air, but we saw the effect of air because the balloon got bigger, right? Okay. So now I'm going to tie it. So I have now tied my balloon. Now, if I let go of this balloon, what's going to happen? You think it's going to drop to the ground? Okay, let's see. Oh, you're right. So, what made this balloon drop to the ground?
Air.
Gravity. Gravity made it drop to the ground. So, can you see the gravity? No. We can't see gravity, but we saw the effect of gravity because it dropped to the ground. Well, this balloon reminds me of God. Can we see air? No. Can we see gravity? Can we see God? No. Can we see the effect of air? Yes, because the balloon got bigger. Can we see the effect of gravity? Yes, because it dropped to the ground. And we can see the effect of God through his love for us. And our Bible story this morning in Sunday school was about a disciple. Who was that disciple? Thomas. And sometimes we call Thomas Doubting Thomas. Why? And he had to what? He had to see before he would believe that Jesus was alive, right? And our Bible verse this month is, can you awesome. These are words from who? Who said these words?
Jesus.
And who is he talking about? Who is happy? Yes, all of us. Christians are happy because we believe, right? We believe that Jesus is alive. Okay? And we're going to say a little prayer. So bow your heads and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for stories.
That help me to believe in Jesus.
Help me to live,
help me to live
by following Jesus' example.
By following Jesus'
so that others may also believe. Thank you for loving me.
Thank you for loving me.
Each and every day.
Each and every day.
Amen.
Amen.
So I brought a balloon for you so you can remember our lesson. You can just grab one. Another color.
I come.
It's joy to sing in such a choir. Thank you, Tammy, and especially our soloists today. How have you experienced God's blessing this week? Where do you in your life feel blessed by God?
Yesterday was awesome.
Yesterday was awesome, a great seminar. Thanks to all the folks who helped set that up. How have you experienced God's blessing? Cindy appreciates seeing her great nephew being born. You were there.
Yeah, we were there after he was born.
We got to see him. Okay.
He was born on Tuesday.
Okay, wonderful.
And then hopefully his life will continue as good as hopefully we can get him then become a Christian one day.
Yeah. I have a blessing I'd like to share with you. I see some smirks out there. Some of you have met a woman that I have been dating for several years now, and we have decided to get married. Mary Colquitt and I will be married on May 28th, on a Saturday. That's coming up soon, I know, but we're tired of long-distance relationships. We would like to invite you, our friends, to join us on that day here in the church. What are you thankful for? Holler it out. Speak up.
Grandchildren.
Family. Yes. Let's get a microphone up here for Tina, because that sounds like something important.
My mom just recently had a house fire down in Texas and lost their home, and she has decided to move here and be closer to family, so wow. I thank God for keeping her safe.
Amen. And what a joy that'll be to have her up here close. Okay, Ed.
My youngest son just got a job in Independence, Kansas. He'd been wanting to get a little farther east, and he starts there next year.
Congratulations to him. What are you thankful for?
I'm thankful for going down to St. Louis in May.
Jim's thankful for going to St. Louis in May.
For my birthday.
For your birthday. Happy birthday, then. We'll
42.
42? Well, you don't look a day over 40.
Kids with a Mission cleaned up the park on Wednesday.
Kids with a Mission cleaned up the park on Wednesday. We have some great kids and some great leaders. Deb.
Just a thank you to all you wonderful people that made my birthday very special. And some of my family flew in and surprised me, but then they didn't really surprise me because they blew the surprise, but that's okay. It was still a great time with them, so.
Well, happy birthday to you. 42. Okay. Kathy.
I am very thankful that my oldest son, Robin, and his wife are going to be living with me.
Isn't that wonderful?
For that, yes.
We're so happy for you. Anybody else? Blessings, thanksgivings. Let's join together in our next hymn, I Come to the Garden. You may remain seated. gratitude for God's presence in our lives we can never express fully. But a way that we can show that thanksgiving is to return back a small portion of what God's given us. Would the ushers come forward now to receive the offering? Gracious God, make of us joyful and thankful givers as we give back to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. He said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God." I have some friends who have a rather interesting hobby. They repair broken pottery. But they don't just fix it. They don't just glue together cracked pieces. They can put those things back together with the special glues, and then they use little airbrushes and spray paint them. And if there's a piece missing, they'll build it back up and make it look like it was never broken at all. You wouldn't be able to tell that these pieces had ever been broken, because they are able to repair those pieces of broken pottery. I think that God is sort of like that, a collector and mender of discarded, broken, and imperfect vessels. In fact, God seems to prefer working with broken vessels. Time after time, God has chosen what seemed to be the weakest, the slowest, and the least regarded of instruments to work with In fact, God blesses brokenness. That's not to say that God wants us to be or to remain broken. Far from it. God wants us to be whole. And yet God knows that when you bring imperfect humans into an imperfect world, something or someone is going to get broken. And then when we are broken, God does not cast us off. In fact, it is often the case that it's only when we are used up, broken-hearted, and broken-spirited with nothing left that God comes to us in the strongest and most meaningful way. It is when we are consumed by our problems that God says, "Don't worry so much. You're not alone in this, you know." It is when we have hit the bottom that we sense God there with us. It's when we've given up on all our dreams and hopes for our lives, our hope for finding joy in living. That is when God shows up and says, "Now you're ready. Come with me. I will give you fullness of life." It is when we feel most inadequate that God makes us strongest. It's when we've seen the hope for redemption for ourselves and our world crucified. It's when we are most disappointed, when we've seen all our visions and dreams dashed. It's when we've given up and headed back home on our own Emmaus Road that Jesus shows up to have fellowship with us and to feed us. It is often the case that when we are broken is precisely the time when Jesus comes to us and shares his love with us in the most powerful ways. I believe that Jesus understands brokenness better than we can imagine. Remember that after his death, he came to his disciples just as he was when he was buried. Broken, beaten, wounded, pierced with nail marks in his hands. The Savior of the world was not the champion as the world defines. In the world's view, Jesus was a loser. And that's partly because Jesus did not come to be served, but to serve. He was, in fact, the suffering servant. The Lord who chose to suffer on behalf of his people so that they might be saved. When Jesus was raised from the dead, he didn't lose those scars. In fact, that was how he showed his disciples that he was who he said he was, by the scars, by the wounds. That's how we know that Jesus is who he says he is. He's broken and gives himself for our sake. I wonder if that may be part of the reason why Jesus seems to prefer to work with broken people, because he too was broken and given for us. Maybe that's why Jesus broke the bread at the Last Supper. And then when he appeared again to the disciples, he met on the road to Emmaus, the broken loaf is the symbol of our Lord and the symbol of the church, the broken body of Christ. Jesus doesn't feed us with whole loaves, fresh and pretty, straight out of the oven. Jesus takes the whole loaf, blesses it, breaks it up and shares it with us. Maybe that's a symbol for the life Jesus wants us to live, not to wait until we have faith enough, not to wait until we're healed, to share ourselves with God and each other and the world. Maybe Jesus wants us to take all that we've received, the good and the bad, to seek God's blessing on it and to share ourselves, broken and redeemed, and made whole again. Even in our brokenness, especially in our brokenness, God wants us to share ourselves with each other and with the world, which is full of other broken, hurting, and imperfect people. God has called us, has called you to be part of a community of broken but faithful people. We don't come together just when things are going our way. We come together when we're sick, when we're lonely, when we're hurting, when our lives have fallen apart. We come together even when we're not sure that we want to sit by each other. Even when we're disagreeing with each other. And we're angry with each other. We come together when we've lost our most beloved ones and our hearts are breaking. We come together when our faith seems weak and we're not sure what or even if we believe anymore. We come together because we are not intended to eat our broken loaves in isolation. Jesus has been made known to us in the breaking of our loaves, in the brokenness of our lives. Jesus becomes most present to us in the sharing of our brokenness with Him and with each other. In fact, we have some of our best fellowship when we're ready to let down our guard, when we're ready to tell each other how we've suffered and how we've been broken. Jesus doesn't wait until we've got our act cleaned up to share broken bread with us. He doesn't wait until we've figured it all out. He doesn't wait until we're through grieving our losses. He doesn't wait until we've forgiven each other and made up. He doesn't wait until we're ready to let go of our guilt and sense of shame over our past sins and bad choices. Jesus comes to us while we are yet broken. Jesus died for us while we were yet sinners, which surely proves God's love and grace toward us. This is the way that Jesus has shown us to live, to receive our broken lives in faith that God will bless us and use us even through our brokenness.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, when your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I'm gonna say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Amen. Amen. Blessed be God's name. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, broken as we are, you come to us and you ask us to follow. Give us grace to receive your blessing and respond as we walk the Emmaus Road, as we learn from you, and as we find you in the breaking of the bread. In your name, we pray now that prayer that you taught your disciples when you said,
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's stand and join together in our closing hymn, Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
Thank you.
please join me now in the benediction in unison?
People of the road, rejoice, for God is with you. Bring God's love and peace to all whom you meet. Go in peace now and forever. Amen.